Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Twitter, a Biography by Jean Burgess and Nancy K. Baym. Narrated by Rachel Perry. Introduction. In 2016, Twitter turned 10. By the middle of that year, it was claiming 313 million monthly active users, 82% of whom were using the platform on mobile devices. It had 3,860 employees, 35-plus offices around the world, 79% non-U.S. accounts, 40-plus supported languages, and 1 billion unique visits monthly to sites where tweets are embedded. Although it was founded in the U.S., Twitter is very international, with large and active populations of users outside the English-speaking world, including in Japan, India, Indonesia, and Brazil, and even to an extent in China, where the service is officially blocked. In August 2018, the word Twitter appeared in the title of approximately 61,300 of the academic articles listed by Google Scholar, and it had been the principal subject of at least two scholarly books, with the number of publications still growing strongly. Twitter has been described as a nervous system for the planet and a global newsroom hosting large amounts of real-time data about social behavior and public communication. It has become the go-to site for journalists seeking to follow the flow of news. Its offering of massive amounts of tweets that can be computationally scraped and analyzed has given rise to whole new fields of social science and humanities research. Many journalists, academics, and politicians are virtually dependent on it as a social listening, professional dialogue, and public relations tool. And it is widely considered an essential component of civic infrastructure for emergency communication. The sense that Twitter matters to the world in such significant ways stands in marked contrast to its far more humble, mundane, and intimate beginnings. Twitter was officially launched in July 2006. In its earliest incarnation, it was a very lightweight service for updating your friends about your whereabouts, thoughts, or everyday activities, as the early concept drawing for a status service by Jack Dorsey shows. Its original intent, in other words, was to be of importance on an interpersonal rather than geopolitical scale. Before it was even called Twitter, let alone had its own company, the idea for the service was developed as a side project within Audio, a startup focused on podcasting products. Its first version could be used through a website initially registered as twttr.com, which displayed all updates from all users in one public timeline and in the U.S. via SMS on mobile phones. Hence, its original and once-defining limitation of 140 characters, leaving a buffer of 20 inside the hard limit of 160 characters per SMS. Twitter had its effective coming-out party at South by Southwest, SXXW, Conference and Music Festival, in March 2007, where it cemented its place as the social networking site of choice for the influencers of the predominantly white, educated, and urban U.S. technology community. At the conference, Twitter created buzz and encouraged use of their product by displaying live tweets from the event on plasma screens in the hallways between meeting rooms. The fledgling product team eventually took home the Web Award in the blog category for that year. South by Southwest marks the moment of mass take-up for the tech community and Twitter's first moment of mass hype. Gawker's Nick Douglas reported that Twitter had blown up with activity on the service, jumping from 20,000 to 60,000 messages per day during the conference. The buzz reached us, too. We each created our own accounts in the first quarter of 2007. As people who study social life and the internet, and who were already part of the blogging scene, Twitter had reached a level of importance that seemed to mandate our participation, or at least observation. Our own initial tweets reflect the site's allure, the aesthetic of the quotidian status update, and what was, at the time, a typical uncertainty about what Twitter was for. Jean's first tweet, posted from her original and now private account on 7 March 2007, was a direct and mundane response to the service's original prompt question. What are you doing? Hunched over my computer as usual, but happy that it's raining outside. Nancy's, posted a week later on 14 March, was even more typical of first tweets in the early years of the platform. Signing up for Twitter, even though I don't think I want it. Like Jean's, Nancy's tweet followed the standard syntax of a personal update, with the addition of reflexive ambivalence about signing up to yet another social media service, a recognition that back then, there seemed to be a new one launching just about every day. Gradually, alongside our friends, colleagues, and Twitter-only acquaintances, we experimented with different forms, genres, and purposes of tweeting, and took part in on-platform discussions and sometimes arguments about the platform's emergent and competing norms. Early on, there were debates about what using Twitter should even be called, in a sure sign that the service represented a new development in digital media. Commentators experimented with various categories, with many calling it a microblogging service, as in Mark Glazer of Media Shift's introductory Twitter and microblogging tutorial. Some calling it a social network site, and others developing hybrid categories by virtue of comparison to existing services, like the then-popular MySpace or Dodgeball. Jason Kotke's comparison of bloggers and Twitter's early growth in the frequency of posts demonstrates our habit of trying to make sense of new phenomena using existing categories, even when they don't quite fit. Twitter was not entirely unlike blogging, but it was definitely something distinct, something that didn't yet have a name, and yet something which seemed to threaten the blog platform business. With a minimalist interface guided only by a prompt that encouraged the expression of personal, real-time experience in compact form, Twitter's ambiguity almost demanded that its users develop their own ideas about what to do with it. The earliest users, predominantly American technorati and bloggers, in other words, those already used to experimenting with and reflecting on their participation in new media, quickly developed and shared their ideas about how Twitter should be used. A form of public pedagogy emerged, whether to help others out or gain attention as Twitter experts. Bloggers wrote copious, "What is Twitter and how to use it?" articles for at least the first few years of Twitter's existence. Those posts that circulated on well-read blogs got the most attention. This meant that from the beginning, the public conversation about what Twitter was and what it should be used for was shaped significantly by tech influencers, mostly white, a lot of them men, and with technical expertise and professional identities tied up with journalism, software development, and especially blogging. A couple of years later, in the face of what seemed like a very deliberate attempt to shape Twitter's communicative norms in certain directions, and with the recent release of Jonathan Zittrain's book, The Future of the Internet and How to Stop It, we began joking on Twitter about writing a book called Twitter, You're Doing It Wrong, and How to Stop It. By mid-2007, the platform was receiving significant mainstream media and technology press attention. Politicians John Edwards and Barack Obama were there by May 2007, as were leading international media outlets like the BBC, Al Jazeera, and the New York Times. Meanwhile, a wide and diverse range of communities, subcultures, and scenes were finding Twitter and making it their own. Comedians, fans of popular culture, academics, and activists. In the U.S., one of the earliest, most visible, and because it made non-white cultural practices so obviously important, most attention-gaining of these emergent communities was Black Twitter, which Andre Brock describes as the use of Twitter's rigid format to articulate Black discursive styles and cultural iconography in a way that subverts mainstream expectations of Twitter demographics, discourses, and utility. In Australia, Indigenous cultural and intellectual leaders created innovative and culturally appropriate forms of media activism around the rotating at Indigenous X account, from which a different Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander person tweets each week, and hashtag Indigenous X hashtag, connecting Australia's Indigenous communities with each other and with First Nations people the world over. Attention from mainstream celebrities brought new users flooding to the platform. Oprah's first tweet, posted live on her show, was a major moment, not only for the platform's mass take-up, but for its presence as a part of mainstream media culture. The event was beleaguered by technical difficulties and characterized by a touch-and-go atmosphere, feeding the mythology of the scrappy startup starting to make it big, while simultaneously revealing the company's less than robust technical systems and processes in these early years. The service was notorious for its unreliable infrastructure. The problems were so pervasive that when the site replaced its jokey LOL cat images with Australian artist Yi Ying Lu's illustration of a whale being lifted into the air by birds, the image became so familiar to users that the expression "fail whale" came into stand-in for Twitter's frequent outages, just as the blue screen of death came to stand-in for crashes in the Windows computer operating system. In these early years, Twitter reportedly went through stalled attempts to get acquired, involving talks and negotiations that came close to deals with Yahoo in 2007 and Facebook in 2008. But with none of them coming to fruition, perhaps in part because of the difficulty the fledgling company had in articulating its purpose and vision, Twitter has an ongoing legacy of difficult relationships with other social media companies, impacting especially on the interoperability of Twitter with Facebook and Instagram. The service engaged in multiple experiments with possible business models and multiple CEOs, coming to a head with its 2013 initial public offering of shares in the company to investors. Since going public, Twitter has retained a loyal core user base and has grown steadily, particularly internationally. But it has consistently lacked the stratospheric year-on-year user growth demanded by investors and shareholders. The device and app ecosystem for Twitter has also changed very significantly over its lifetime. Like the technical side of ads, hashtags, and retweets, the apps we use to access Twitter have evolved, and their evolution has influenced how we experience, use, and think about the platform. There are two distinctive phases in Twitter's relationship with the third-party developer community. Initially, Twitter encouraged the development of apps that allowed people to access and use Twitter in different ways and on different devices, often delivering on ideas from the user community. Around 2009, as Twitter matured and began to get serious about issues like the consistency of its visual branding, it began to exert more control over these third-party developments through changes made to its application programming interfaces, APIs, the coded instructions that tell one software application how to talk to another, and the developer rules associated with them. These changes significantly limited the entrepreneurial opportunities for third-party developers to build new businesses on the platform. A pattern began to emerge whereby Twitter bought up the third-party applications it wanted to incorporate into the platform and locked the others out by changing the APIs and their rules. These moves largely shut out third-party mobile app developers at the same time that users were migrating en masse to mobile devices. While user clients were the most visible face of this shutting out of third-party developers, it affected other services and tools originally developed outside the Twitter company itself. Examples include URL shortening services, image sharing applications, and even search. The Twitter search function you use today was built on a third-party search engine developed by a company called Surmise, which Twitter acquired in 2008. Indeed, the events of 2010 and 2011 emphatically marked Twitter's turn away from the Web 2.0 open innovation paradigm within which value is added by third-party developers, and the return on investment for venture capitalists can be deferred, at least for a while, toward a centralized, advertising-driven one, within which the user experience and user metrics need to be contained and controlled. And as we have written about elsewhere, the restrictions on APIs, the key protocols that enable and constrain uses of Twitter's affordances and data by third parties, had a serious impact on data access for public researchers, too. Twitter's competing cultures. From the start, Twitter was an enigmatic platform, open to multiple uses, populated by passionate insiders, mysterious to outsiders. As we will see, some common values have emerged among diverse stakeholders, such as protecting the integrity of the feed, the capacity to organize users and conversations, and giving appropriate credit to the ideas of others. Yet Twitter's meanings and role have always been ambiguous, and early usage patterns betray subtle but significantly different understandings of its purpose, the source of its potential value, and the kinds of relationships that were meant to be built and sustained between users. Amid all this diversity of uses, there has always been a particular tension between the idea of a simple social technology for updating your friends, on the one hand, and an informational public communication platform, on the other. The original prompt for user updates, which could be performed via SMS or the website, focused clearly on real-time reporting of personal activity, asking, "What's your status?" soon replaced with the more personal, "What are you doing?" which remained in place for the first few years. The pitch to users was clearly focused on ambient intimacy, the mundane sharing and peripheral awareness of everyday experiences, thoughts, and activities among small groups of close friends or colleagues. From the beginning, the founders had dreams of the platform going global, but as related by journalist Nick Bilton, in his book, Hatching Twitter, two of the main drivers of the platform in those first years, Jack Dorsey and Evan Ev Williams, had significantly different visions of the tool's purpose and value. According to Bilton, it was Ev who pushed for the 2009 change to the tagline from the status update question, "What are you doing?" to the more news-oriented question, "What's happening?" In keeping with his insistence that Twitter was an information network rather than a social one. "Twitter is not a social network. It's an information network," Williams told a crowd at South by Southwest in 2009, as Nancy, who was in attendance, noted that she was doing it wrong.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.